may begin.
Alright. As the board knows, my name is Eric Chofnas. I have the privilege of being here once again on behalf of the appellant in this matter, Jeff Chance. In the Superior Court, we had oral argument. It lasted about 3 hours. In that proceeding, I also went first, and I spent roughly an hour and a half talking about this case. Then Mr. Buckley came to the podium, but before he began, Judge Bagley asked him a question. He asked him, isn't this exactly the kind of case the civil service system is intended to cover? Isn't it supposed to protect county employees from politically motivated terminations? And I bring that up because I think it's an important question. And in one sense, the reason that you're here listening to us again is that you still need to answer that question. If the purpose of the civil service system isn't to protect county employees from political retribution, then why have a civil service board at all? Now, in your original ruling, after hearing 8 days of testimony, this board wrote, the board finds that the investigation of eventual discipline against you was motivated in large part by improper political motives and accompanied by a poor quality investigation. After weighing all the evidence, that was your ultimate conclusion. Both the county's investigation of Jeff and its eventual decision to terminate him were, quote, motivated in large part by improper political motives, unquote. In the Superior Court, I argued that this amounted to a ruling in Jeff's favor on his pretext claim. And I argued that based on this finding and other findings in the ruling, this board was required to give Jeff his job back to protect him from what this board itself called, quote, improper political motives, unquote. I also argued that this board committed legal error in its ruling when it held the board is without jurisdiction to take action as to the improper political action beyond filing the ethics complaint it felt compelled to bring to the public's attention based on the sworn testimony in your appeal. I hope all of you, not just Mr. Miles, have carefully reviewed the Superior Court's ruling. If you haven't, I hope you will. The Superior Court agreed that this particular aspect of your holding was incorrect. Therefore, it reversed your ruling and held that this board does in fact have jurisdiction to grant relief based on Jeff's pretext claim. In fact, the Superior Court went much further. In its ruling, Judge Bagley held that if the evidence showed such political motives as you've already found in your ruling, then this board required to reinstate Jeff. At page 7 of his order, Judge Bagley wrote, at its essence, Chance's claims focus on the Civil Service Board's refusal to consider his belief that his termination by the BOC is politically motivated and pretextual. Chance specifically argues throughout his petition that his determination concerning United Recycling Inc. Salvage Yard Conditional Use Permit, or CUP, upset then Commissioner Charlie Laughinghouse and Planning Commissioner Board of Commissioners candidate Grant Meadows, resulting in the underlying and true basis for his termination. Certainly, the termination of a civil servant based upon such political motives, if proven true, is the type of, quote, improper, unquote, dismissal that the Forsyth civil service system seeks to remedy. Now that we have new documents in the record, we know that it wasn't just Meadows and Laughinghouse. We know that Harold and Boff were also involved in this behind-the-scenes scheming to get Jeff to reverse his decision. And you also see in the record that one of them, Mr. Meadows, on April 22nd, before the county began its investigation, suggested to the three commissioners who eventually would terminate him that Jeff needs to go on a vacation. I don't think he meant vacation, literally. To get back to my argument, as we've already seen in your original ruling, you found that both the county's investigation of Jeff and his termination were, quote, motivated in large part by improper political motives, unquote. under the Superior Court's ruling and well-established legal principles. That finding, in itself, requires you to rule in Jeff's favor and give him his job back. And I'm going to spend the rest of the morning explaining why that's the case. Now, in addition, in his ruling, Judge Bagley held that the political motives of Planning Commissioner Meadows in filing his open records request and in initiating the investigation of Jeff are, quote, highly relevant, unquote, to this issue. At page 10 of Judge Bagley's orders, he wrote, even though the court agrees with the general proposition, the political motivations of open records requests are irrelevant to a civil service board's inquiry under the facts of this case where the civil servant raises as a defense to the termination of Spectre that the open records request was politically motivated by the employer, allegedly using a straw person, and where the county's investigation was found to have been, quote, sloppy at best and inaccurate at worst, unquote. And the county's personnel director is found to have been, quote, here he's quoting you and your ruling, running down rabbit trails that were pushed for political reasons, unquote. And political motivations surrounding the termination become highly relevant. So, after Judge Bagley's ruling, a couple things are clear, maybe weren't clear before. It's clear that preventing this type of politically motivated termination is within your jurisdiction. Now, I wasn't present during your deliberations, so I can't be certain how the board originally came to a different conclusion. But I would speculate that it might have something to do with the fact that there is also a separate action that we file under the Whistleblower Act that is pending in the Superior Court. However, in its ruling, the Superior Court also made it clear that the existence of that separate lawsuit in no way limits Jeff's rights before this board. At page 10 of his order, Judge Bagley wrote, Chance's Whistleblower Act suit should not be allowed to, and in fact does not, envelop, displace, or otherwise hinder Chance's remedies under the county's civil service laws. That act has its own jurisdictional and procedural requirements and remedies which are separate from those afforded by Forsyth Civil Services. To otherwise limit Chance's remedies under the civil service system as sought by the county would result in a denial of Chance's procedural due process rights under the federal and state constitution. The whistleblower statute is not designed to cut off a civil servant's other legal remedies. To the contrary, it acts as a supplement to the civil servant's other remedy. And this is something that was discussed at the original hearing, in particular in connection with the motion in limine. And what I argued and what the hearing officer held is that there was really concurrent jurisdiction in this situation. The Civil Service Board had jurisdiction to hear the employee's claims of a pretext, whether it's Whistleblower Act or race, and that did not limit its federal and state remedies. They just operated completely independent of each other. So after the Superior Court's ruling that I just read, it's clear that that separate lawsuit does not in any way limit your jurisdiction or your duty to protect county employees from improper political retribution. Now, as I said, in the Superior Court, I asked the court to rule on this issue as a matter of law and to immediately order Jeff's reinstatement. My argument was that based on the numerous factual findings in your ruling relating to the question of pretext, this board would be required as a matter of law to rule in Jeff's favor on this issue. Therefore, I argue to the court that it should decide this issue itself as a matter of law and that it wasn't necessary to remand the case. The Superior Court, if you look at its order, declined to do that at this time, declined to rule on this issue as a matter of law, and instead it remanded the case to you. However, today, I'm making a similar argument to this board. On remand, you don't have to make any new factual findings. If you simply reaffirm the findings that you made in your original ruling, then as a matter of law, you must rule in Jeff's favor on the issue of pretext. If you apply Judge Bagley's legal ruling and his order to the factual findings in your ruling that you made before, there's simply no other rational result that you can reach. Now, this leads to a basic question. In the employment law context, what does the term pretext mean? In our brief, I tried to explain that issue, and as I said before, I hope that you all have had an opportunity to review it, and that after this you'll go back and review it. But either way, I'm going to try to retrace the argument this morning, but either way, if you have any questions along the way, I encourage and urge you to interrupt me so I can make sure that I answer. Now, as you know, there are various federal and state laws making it unlawful for an employer to base its employment actions on certain prohibited motives. Examples of these motives include discrimination based on race, color, national origin, religion, gender, and age. Employee claims that are brought under these laws are often identified as Title VII discrimination claims, which refers to the federal law that prohibits employer actions based on these motives. The courts have also held that it is unlawful for an employer to take any adverse employment action against an employee in retaliation for opposing such discriminatory practices or for asserting his or her legally protected rights. And that type of case is referred to as a Title VII retaliation claim. And as I note in our brief, retaliation claims can also arise outside of the Title VII context under various federal and state whistleblower statutes, such as Georgia's Whistleblower Act, which is an issue here. Now, how does the issue of pretext arise? Well, it arises when an employer denies the allegation that its employment action was based on a prohibited motive or taken for retaliatory purposes. Instead, the employer proffers, as the term in the case is used, legitimate, non-retaliatory reasons for its actions. As we show in our brief, the law has developed specific analytic tests to apply to determine whether the employer's proffered legitimate reasons are pretextual. If the employer's proffered legitimate reasons are pretextual and the employer's actual motive is either discriminatory or retaliatory, then the employer's actions must be deemed unlawful. Now, an important point that you need to keep in mind in considering these issues is that under this test, it is solely the employer's motive that renders its actions unlawful. Therefore, even if there is factual support, evidentiary support for the employer's proffered legitimate reasons, they will be deemed pretextual if, in actuality, the employer was acting based on a prohibited motive or for retaliatory purpose. Now, as I stated before, in the Superior Court, my argument was that the board's factual findings that you made in the ruling show that it accepted our, that you accepted our pretext argument. One thing that I pointed out is that in the ruling, the board rejected the majority of charges that the county had made against Jeff in its, quote, investigative summary of Jeff Chance, June 20, 2010, quote, which was the basis, as you know, for the commissioner's decision, which I'm going to refer to this morning simply as a report. In the context of a pretext analysis, the report and its findings constitute the county's, quote, proffered legitimate reasons, unquote, for Jeff's termination. My point, therefore, is that this board has already explicitly rejected the vast majority of the employer's proffered legitimate reasons. Moreover, in the ruling, this board wrote, at the outset, the board would be remiss if it did not note that the quality of the investigation that resulted in your discipline was poor. As correctly observed by your counsel, the investigation was sloppy at best and inaccurate at worst. The findings were often not supported by the evidence, and even when questioned by at least Commissioner Bell, the findings were not re-examined. Nevertheless, the Board of Commissioners, by majority vote, decided to terminate you based upon all 12 findings, and apparently Mr. Bell's warning ring was not heeded. So the four factual findings that you made in your ruling on this issue are, number one, most of the findings in the report are false or, quote, not supported by the evidence, unquote. And number two, you found that the commissioners were well aware of these defects before they voted to terminate Jeff, but that they chose not to re-examine the report's findings or to question the reasons for these defects. Now, as we show in our brief, the type of errors, misstatements, and inconsistencies that you found in the report are precisely the type of evidence that the courts have relied upon traditionally to establish pretext. Simply stated, the courts will infer an unlawful motive from factors such as false or unsupported charges, selective or inconsistent enforcement of employment policies, disparate disciplinary action or similar violations, and false or implausible explanations by the employer regarding for the reasons for its actions, which I think is particularly applicable here. As the board's factual findings and the rulings demonstrate, the record in this case is full of such evidence, and that is what I believe led the board to directly criticize the county for, quote, running down rabbit trails that were pushed for political reasons. Moreover, this board went further in its ruling, and specifically held in Jeff's favor on the issue of the county's unlawful motive. As I stated before, at page 6 of the ruling, the board wrote, "The board finds that the investigation and eventual discipline against you was motivated in large part by improper political motives and accompanied by a full quality investigation." So, as I explained in our brief, this finding of improper political motives, for all intents and purposes, is a ruling in Jeff's favor on his pretext claim. And in the remainder of my argument this morning, I'm going to try to explain that once again. Now, you may recall that at the hearing, I argued that Jeff's pretext claim had to be decided based on the federal principles that have been developed for dealing with pretext in Title VII cases. At that point, there was no Georgia decision that expressly so held. However, just a few months after the hearing, in Forster v. Georgia Department of Human Services, the Court of Appeals held that such principles govern employee claims under Georgia's Whistleblower Act. Forster expressly adopts the federal burden-shifting analysis of McDonnell Douglas Corp. v. Green, a 1973 U.S. Supreme Court decision, which is discussed in some detail in our brief. And under that case, there is a three-part test. The employee is first required to establish a prima facie case of retaliation. And second, the burden then shifts to the employer to articulate a legitimate non-retaliatory reason for its adverse employment action. And finally, under the third element, the burden shifts back to the employee to show that the stated reasons offered by the employer for its adverse action are in fact pretextual. So, as a practical matter, the third and dispositive element in this burden-shifting analysis will almost always be the issue of pretext that you're here to consider today. Now, as I mentioned before, to establish a pretext claim, an employee is not required to disprove every non-retaliatory reason proffered by the employer. Instead, he can establish that his termination was unlawful in either of two ways. First of all, the employee can show that the legitimate reasons proffered for his termination were not the actual motive for the employer's conduct or were insufficient to justify the disciplinary action that was taken. An example of this approach is in White versus Thyssen, Thyssen, Krupp, K-R-U-P-P, Steel, USA, which is discussed in our brief. And there the court said, the inquiry into pretext requires the court to determine, in view of all the evidence, whether the plaintiff has cast sufficient doubt on the defendant's proffered non-discriminatory reasons, and that a reasonable fact finder can conclude the employer's proffered legitimate reasons were not what actually motivated his conduct, but were a pretext for discrimination. The plaintiff's burden is to demonstrate weaknesses or plausibilities in the proffered legitimate reason, so as to permit a rational jury to conclude that the explanation given was not the real reason, or that the reason stated was insufficient to warrant the adverse action. General way of putting the pretext test was stated by the Third Circuit in Fuentes v. Persky, another case that's discussed in our brief, where it said that a plaintiff can establish pretext by, quote, pointing to some evidence, direct or circumstantial, in which a fact finder could reasonably disbelieve the defendant's articulated reasons, unquote. And as we show in our brief, the type of, quote, inconsistencies, incoherences, and contradictions, unquote, that are referred to throughout these cases permeate the county's report. And I believe that is exactly the reason why this board rejected the majority of its findings. Now, the second method by which an employee can show that his termination was unlawful is under the, quote, mixed motive, unquote, analysis that was first established in Price Waterhouse v. Hopkins, a 1989 U.S. Supreme Court decision. And under that decision, even if there are some legitimate reasons for the termination, it is still illegal if it was motivated in part by an unlawful motive. Now, 2 years after the Price Waterhouse decision, Congress enacted the Civil Rights Act of 1991, which eased the standard of proof that was announced in Price Waterhouse, such that an employee can prevail on a mixed motive claim simply by showing that the prohibited reason, the prohibited animus, was a, quote, motivating factor, unquote, not necessarily a, quote, but-for, unquote, factor, as had been the case under the original ruling of Price Waterhouse. Now, later in a 2003 decision, Desert Palace Inc. v. Costa, which was also discussed in our brief, the Supreme Court once again held that following the 1991 Act, to prevail on a mixed motive claim, an employee only needs to show that the prohibited animus was a factor in the employment action. So if you apply the mixed motive analysis to this case, Jeff's termination was illegal if, quote, improper political motives, unquote, were a factor in the commissioner's decision, even assuming for purposes of argument that there were some legitimate reasons for that action. To avoid liability, the county would be required to show that it would have taken the exact same adverse employment action, even in the absence of the prohibited motive. That is what is referred to generally in the case law as the mixed motive defense. Now, in Young v. St. James Management, LLC, right here, the court explained the practical impact of the mixed motive analysis and stated, to succeed on a Title VII claim using a mixed motive approach, a plaintiff may only present sufficient evidence for a reasonable jury to conclude by a preponderance of the evidence race, color, religion, sex, or national origin was a motivating factor for any employment practice. The Title VII mixed motive formulation anticipates that there may be both a legitimate and prohibited reason for the defendant's action. Thus, the defendant cannot avoid liability simply by pointing to a legitimate reason for the adverse employment action. Also, in the case of Curley v. St. John's University, the court explained that the 1991 Civil Rights Act largely eliminated any distinctions between pretext and mixed motive cases. The court wrote, the 1991 Act has erased the key distinctions between parties' burdens of pretext and mixed motive analysis. Pretext and mixed motive thus are not two kinds of cases, but two kinds of liability findings based on two kinds of showings plaintiffs can attempt to make. Only a mix of motives is plausible if the defendant clearly has some discriminatory motivation. Only pretext is plausible where on the particular evidence, no reasonable trier could find that two motives could have simultaneously existed. So what does all that mean? I know it's a little bit boring, but it's important. What it means is that you have to decide the pretext case. There are two possibilities that you have to consider. First, the report and the reasons that were offered in it were not the true reason for Jeff's termination, that it was really improper political motives, or alternatively, that whatever legitimate reasons might have existed, they weren't sufficient to justify the result. The second approach is the mixed motive approach. Even if you assume, for purposes of argument, that there were some legitimate reasons that the employer considered, if an improper political motives were even a factor in their decision, it would be unlawful. Now, if we take these principles and look at your findings, I think it shows that you've already found that Jeff's termination violated the whistleblower act. You're finding that the investigation and eventual discipline against you was motivated in large part by improper political motives is, in effect, a finding that requires you to hold that the action was pretextual. And even assuming arguendo that the county acted in part based on non-retaliatory reasons, your finding would still establish that Jeff's termination was unlawful under the mixed motive analysis. And as we explained, if it was a motivating factor for the county's decision for the action it took, then it would be unlawful. And in this case, as I noted, the ruling goes much farther than just finding it was a factor. It finds that it was motivated in large part by the prohibited motives. Now, the county has previously raised the mixed motive defense, namely that it would have terminated Jeff, notwithstanding any improper political motive. However, as discussed in our brief, that defense failed on various grounds. First, it's contrary to your actual findings in the ruling. As I just said, finding that Jeff's termination and the investigation against him was largely motivated by impermissible factors is by definition an explicit rejection of the mixed motive defense. Secondly, as you also found in this case, the county's investigation of Jeff was initiated in retaliation for activity that's protected under the Whistleblower Act. Therefore, the investigation itself was tainted from the very outset. And if you look at Judge Bagley's ruling, part of it we already looked at, he made it perfectly clear, if it wasn't before, that the motives surrounding the Open Records Act request and the investigation, not just the termination decision, are relevant to this question of whether this is an improper, politically motivated termination. And thirdly, as you may recall from the hearing, the record shows that the county was prepared to take far lesser disciplinary action against Jeff until he went public with his allegation and filed his whistleblower lawsuit. I remember Commissioner Bell testifying that once that happened, Chairman Laughinghouse refused to discuss any lesser action or any other resolution of the termination. And Jeff's testimony about conversations with Brian Tam about some type of deal short of termination. My point is that this type of retaliatory termination is itself a separate violation of the Whistleblower Act. And finally, the reason you can't sustain their mixed motive defense is that in your ruling, you sustained only three of the 12 findings in the report and severely criticized its investigation. And those findings, those rejections, and those criticisms are absolutely inconsistent with any claim by the county that its investigation and its decision to terminate Jeff was not affected by the improper political motives that you have already found. Therefore, that would also stand as a separate ground for rejecting county's mixed motive defense. Now I want to touch on something else in the ruling I stated before that to establish a pretext claim, an employee does not need to disprove all the legitimate reasons proffered by the employer for its adverse employment action. And in our brief, we discussed the case of Williams versus Wells Fargo. It's a 2008 case in federal court in Pennsylvania. And there the court wrote, if the employee casts doubt on a fair number of legitimate reasons advanced by the employer, he need not discredit the remainder. The rejection of some explanations may so undermine the employer's credibility that a rational fact finder could disbelieve the remaining reasons. And that goes back to the point I've made several times now. To be illegal, all you need is a prohibited or retaliatory motive. That is the essence of what you were deciding here today. In your ruling, the board wrote, as I pointed out, the board finds that the investigation and eventual discipline against you was motivated in large part by improper political motives and accompanied by a poor quality investigation. That wrong, however, cannot diminish the wrong of your behavior. Nevertheless, two wrongs don't make a right. And I bring that up because while two wrongs don't make a right is a recognized common sense expression, it is completely contrary to the pretext analysis that you have to engage in under federal and state laws, employment laws. As Williams and all the other cases that are discussed in our brief show, the dispositive issue is simply whether the employee's actions were based either in whole or in part on a prohibitive motive. And this approach, I think you should recognize, is based on an explicit recognition by the Congress and the state legislatures that there are some employer motives that are just so invidious that they have to be eliminated from the workplace. And I would submit to you that this reasoning, this legislative reasoning, is especially compelling when you're talking about a governmental employer through its high-ranking political officials willfully violating a law that is intended to promote integrity in government, such as in this case, Georgia's Whistleblower Act. And let me just throw in, after you look at the new exhibit that was introduced in the House today, I think you get an idea that that's exactly what was going on and how widespread it was. It wasn't just Meadows acting like Meadows, as the county tried to make it believe. Hearing involved Laughing House, Harold, and Bob all acting to force Jeff to reverse a decision regarding United Recycling that they knew was correct, according to Laughing House's own testimony, and that they have told you that it was correct. The whole thing was a charade and completely illegal. They all knew what they were doing. If you read those emails, you'll know exactly who was involved and what the timing was. Take those emails, line them up against the timeline that's already in the record, and you will draw your own conclusions. All right, so to summarize, in order to establish his pretext claim, Jeff was required to show at the hearing that the county's proffered reasons for investigating and terminating were pretextual, and secondly, that the county's actual motives, either in whole or in part, were unlawful. And I think, as I've said many times now, it's clear from the ruling that we met the first element of that test. But to understand how the record also establishes the second element, the violation of the Whistleblower Act, you need to consider the specific provisions of that statute. Now, the Whistleblower Act, most commonly, is referred to as protecting employers for retaliation for disclosures that are protected under the law. Thus, in the statute, section 45-1-4(d)(2) provides that no public employer shall retaliate against a public employee for disclosing a violation of, as that word disclosing, or non-compliance with law, rule, or regulation, either a supervisor or a government agency, unless the disclosure was made, knowledge that the disclosure was false, or with reckless disregard for its truth or falsehood. Now, Jeff clearly made a protected disclosure when on April 21st, 2010, informed the chairman of the Board of Commissioners, the county attorney, and the assistant county administrator, who was his immediate supervisor, about Meadows' illegal demands and threats against him. At that point, if you want to know, and I think they're going to talk about that, is when the law was violated. It was violated when Meadows made demands that he knew violated the rights of United Cycling and also violated Jeff's rights, and when he subsequently threatened him because he refused to go along with it. And that leads me to the second provision of the Whistleblower Act, which is 45-1-4, parental B, close parent, parent 3, close parent, which provides no public employer shall retaliate against a public employee for objecting to or refusing to participate in any activity, policy, or practice of a public employer that the public employee has reasonable cause to believe is in violation of or noncompliance with a law, rule, or regulation. This is really what I just talked about. Jeff's initial refusal to give in to Meadows' illegal demands, which you know now when you read the emails, were coming not just from Meadows, but from Laughing House, Harold, and Boff as well. That was also protected conduct under the statute. What I'm getting at is, in addition to the pretext aspect, we need to show a connection to illegal activity, illegal motive, and that's what this does. It was a violation of the Whistleblower Act. When he first made those demands, threatened to destroy Jeff, and initiated the Open Records Act, as Judge Bagley said in his order, that is also relevant to this issue, and that all constituted unlawful retaliation. But in addition, the Whistleblower Act broadly prescribes, and Section 45, it broadly prescribes any policy or practice that would have the effect of preventing a public employee from making disclosures of violations of the law. And on that issue, Section 45-1-4B1 provides no public employer shall make, adopt, or enforce any policy or practice preventing a public employee from disclosing a violation of or noncompliance with a law, rule, or regulation to either a supervisor or a government agency. And I would submit to you that it's obvious that a policy of retaliatory investigations and terminations directed employees who oppose unlawful practices initiated by these political officials will have a severe chilling effect on protected disclosures, and that constitutes a prohibited policy or practice under 45-1-4D1. Stated more simply, no county employee wants to be the next Jeff Chance, and so they're not going to do what Jeff did and refuse an illegal demand from an elected official. Moreover, the record here strongly supports Jeff's claims, and hopefully you will have the opportunity to go back and carefully review the record. In the time we have and in our brief, it was possible to have a thorough review of the evidence. However, one point that you should note, I believe, is Laughing House's testimony that as of April 20, 2010, both he and Meadows agreed that Jeff was correct when he issued the rule that United Recycling did not need to apply for a new conditional use permit. And this is his testimony, and the relevant portion is at the end. I asked him, so before I move on, if at that point, possibly the 20th, you agree Jeff made the right call, Meadows agreed Jeff made the right call, do I understand your answer? Laughing House's response, correct. But you'll see from Exhibit 62 that on the 22nd, the other two commissioners, Harold and Bob and Laughing House, were working with Meadows to illegally force Jeff to reverse that decision and to presumably give Jeff the vacation that Meadows said he needed to take. All right. I also want to point out that under the threat of imminent litigation, the county at last abandoned a year-long effort to withhold a business license from United Recycling. Attached as Exhibit 1 to our brief which I hope you'll take a careful look at, is a copy of a June 23rd, 2000 letter from the county's council to United Recycling, accompanied by its business license dated June 27, 2011. Thus, even the county has belatedly conceded what Laughing House and Meadows knew and the other by at least April 20th of the previous year, namely Jeff had made the correct decision and that the threats and the coercion and his eventual termination, which destroyed his career and his livelihood, were part of an illegal political scheme fostered by the people whose names appear on those emails that you're going to look at. And I should point out that that conclusion is underscored by Judge Bagley's express holding, which we looked at, that the political motives for Meadows' open records requests and the investigation of Jeff are, quote, highly relevant, unquote, to this board's decision on this issue. The final bit of evidence that I would call your attention to, again, is Commissioner Bell's testimony that I referred to earlier, that once Jeff exercised his rights under the Whistleblower Act, Laughing House insisted on his termination. Jeff filed a whistleblower action on July 9, 2010, which was well before the commissioner's decision to terminate his employment on August 19, 2010. And there's additional evidence regarding that that I referred to. The point is that there's a direct causal connection between Jeff's exercise of his legally protected rights under the Whistleblower Act by filing that lawsuit and the commissioner's decision to terminate. As I mentioned earlier, any decision to terminate Jeff based on his exercise of his legally protected rights is itself unlawful retaliation under Section 45-1-4D1-2-3. So the point is that the connection between the contextual motives for Jeff's termination that are stated in the report and the county's unlawful motives under the Whistleblower Act, I believe, could not be stronger. Now, I want to finish up with the same thing I started with. In the Superior Court, Judge Bagley asked Mr. Buckley a question. Isn't this exactly the kind of case the civil service system is intended to cover? Isn't it supposed to protect county employees from politically motivated terminations? I think that was the right question for the court to ask, and I think it's the question that you gentlemen have to answer now. After the Superior Court's ruling, I know we've gone over a lot of things, but after the Superior Court's ruling, you know that you have both the jurisdiction and the duty to protect Jeff improper political motives cited in the original ruling. I think at this point, particularly after this new evidence, there's no question that both the county's investigation and termination of Jeff were motivated in large part by those unlawful motives. Now, why do I say that? Because you already said exactly the same thing in your ruling. That is what you found the first time. Now, all I'm asking you to do is to do the right thing based on those findings. Have to carry out your solemn duty to enforce the law. And acting on your original findings and applying Judge Bagley's legal rulings, you have to give Jeff his job back. I've got about 20 minutes remaining.
About 17, but that clock.
Okay.
Mr. Miles, may I ask for 5 minutes?
Absolutely. We'll be in recess for 5 minutes. We'll start back.
Thank you. No questions. I was hoping for questions. That's all right.
Mind if I move it over here?
I don't mind at all.
I pre-brought it on, but
that's fine.
Appreciate it.